Hello everybody and welcome to part 2 of this tutorial. And now let's go ahead and save the file. So press Ctrl O to write the to output to the file. It says file name to write. You can actually modify it here, so you can type in some letters or whatever you want. You can change the name here, or you can even change the extension if you want. But there is no need for the time being. I'm just going to go ahead and save it as test. Just press enter. There you go. It says wrote one line. Control X to exit. There we go. Clear the screen. And now I'm going to use cat command to get a listing of this particular file, which is far more reasonable than the previous one, which you couldn't read. The cat command, by the way, was functioning properly, but it was mostly a binary file. Therefore, it gave you a listing, but you couldn't really read anything from it. So let's just go ahead and type in cat test, and there we go. It says some random text goes here. That is the text that we have typed into the text file and test file, and you can cat it like this. These things are very good, especially with files that you want to make sure you do not want to change them in any way, and you don't want to make any accidental changes or anything of a kind, and you want to quickly see what is located within that file. There is another way of doing this. Basically, it's less, and let's go ahead and navigate over to Etsy apt ls, and here we have plenty of files to work with. So let's just take sources.list as an example here. So if I do cat sources.list, I'm gonna get everything that is within that file as before, and it's gonna be listed in my terminal here, there to stay. It's not gonna go away anywhere. But there is another command which I can use. Let me just go ahead and clear the screen. It is called less. And if I type in less sources.list, I'm gonna be prompted with a new tab where I can actually view things here. Not a new terminal tab, but a new workspace within the terminal itself. And when I press Q, it's gonna exit and nothing will be displayed here. So very nice in terms of being neat and organized and so on and so forth. So less and cat, very nice things, but you can use, for example, cat sources.list, and then the command that I have previously mentioned is grep. Grep means basically you pull something, you grep something from something else. Now here's what I mean by it. You type in cat sources.list and you type in a pipe. This symbol here, it's called a pipe, which basically states whatever the output of this is, pipe it to whatever command comes here. So I'm just going to type in grep, and let's say I want to type in src. Press enter. Excellent. So it will only print lines that have src in them. Linux is case sensitive, so when you are grepping, it's going to check the case of the letters, whether it's lowercase or not. But you can give it an ignore case. You can type in like this, dash I means ignore case, oops, my bad, dash I to ignore the case. You're gonna get the same output because there are no different things within this file, but you get the general idea. So this is how you would use cat with grep in order to pull things out of a file. Very important. This is a huge part of the Linux terminal. Filtering through text files, primarily because we're going to be doing large network scans and we will want to create files from which we will be able to pull useful information, which we will later in turn pass to other tools to do something with. Anyway, let me just go ahead and clear the screen for the time being. You also have echo, so echo, and I give it the quotation marks open. Let's say, I am alive, close quotation marks, and it will echo these words. It literally is an echo. You type something into it and it echoes them here. Well, let's just go back to the home directory now, get a listing, and use exactly the same command, echo live. By the way, you can scroll through the previous commands by using arrow key. So using the up arrow key and down arrow key, you can scroll back through your previous commands and you don't need to retype them. So I am alive, and I'm going to insert this So I'm going to use a greater than sign and type in test. So this will echo I am alive into test. And if I do less, I'm going to use cat test. You see, it has replaced the contents of the test, which was some random text goes here, into I am alive. Very nice command to have. You can change variable names, variable values with echo and so on and so forth. We will use this a bit more as we progress through the course, and I don't really want to get in depth here, primarily because later on when we have clear examples that directly relate to what we are doing at the moment, which is basically pen testing, then you will see more advanced usage of pretty much all of these commands, especially grep. We have touch. Touch is a quick way to create files. So for example, I can do touch, and I can say file 1, file 2, file 3. Press enter, ls, and you see it has immediately created 3 files. So touch is a very quick method. Oops, a bit over my head there. Anyway, touch is a very quick way of creating any amount of files that you wish, and you can specify folder paths. You can create this file in home, this one in var log, and so on and so forth. Anyway, down below you have mkdir. So if I go ahead and type in mkdir, it's make directory. So you are making some sort of a directory. Let's say the name of this directory will be place to be. And if I get ls, there we go. It states that this file is actually a directory, which is a place to be. I can even navigate to it and say place to be ls. There is nothing in it, but get the idea. You can make directories in such a fashion. Now chown, if I type chown, it allows you to change the ownership of a particular file. Now since we only have a single user here, which is root, there isn't really any point in doing so unless we create some other new users, but we're not going to do that as we don't need them. But just to show you how this would work, for example, if the owner of a file was not root, and if you wanted to change it to root, you would do the following. So chown, and then you would type the name, the username, colon, the user group. So the user group and the username are usually the same on your home PCs, unless you're on some bigger server or something like that. And then you would just specify the name of the file. I don't know, you can type in test. There we go. So it will change, it will effectively change the ownership of file test to the username root, who is from the user group root. And if I do ls, la, you can see here it states who the owners are and which groups actually own the files as well. So if I clear the screen, there is another more used command. It's called chmod. And this command allows you to change file permissions. So this is something that you will need to use on a daily basis and quite often, primarily because, well, you see, if I have an executable file in Linux, for example, let's just go ahead and edit. Well, actually, we don't need to edit it. We can type in echo, and not like that. Hello, close quotation marks, and I want to output this to test, and I want to move test to test.sh. SH is basically an executable, one of the scripts, that's a bash script for Linux, that in such a way you can automate tasks. We will deal with it in greater depth as we proceed through the tutorial. You will need to be acquainted with bash scripting, definitely, but bash scripting is very similar to the terminal itself, so pretty much all the commands that you use in the terminal you can use in bash scripting as well, basically just combining a bunch of them in a file. And now I want this to be my executable, but you see, the way to start executables is dot slash, as I have stated previously, that's a command to start any executable, and if I type in test and I press tab, it doesn't give me a list of possibilities. Why? Surely now test.sh is an executable, but no. You see, it doesn't have a permission to be an executable file. You see here, the difference, that just take a look at this file and take a look at this file. This one is green, this one is not. And now look at their permissions. So you see it has a markation that it is executable for all groups, users, etc., while this one up here, testsh, does not have such permissions. You need to change that, and in the way you change it is chmod, and you would type in plus x. So if you want the file to be writable, you type in plus w. If you want it to be executable, plus x. If you want to be able to read the file, plus r. Very simple. There is also a way of doing this with numbers, so you can type in 755. You don't try remembering all those modes. Whatever you need, you basically go on the net and check. It can be quite complicated, but these three you need to know. It's plus W, plus R, and plus X. And also 777, which is a global mode. This is the mode that is not recommended for actual usage, but you use chmod to actually test or troubleshoot things. For example, if you want to be absolutely sure that certain actions are not being prevented due to file permissions, you change the mode of those files to 777, which is the global mode that anybody can do anything with the file, and if you still have an error message, you know that it is absolutely not related to anything in regards to permissions. So those four things you do need to know. So let me just go ahead and type in plus x, type in type in test dot sh, press enter, and if I do ls la once again, you will see that test.sh is now executable. Let me just run it, and there you go. If I run this, it's gonna echo hello onto my terminal screen. Now there's a bit more to go, not much more left. There is just one more command that I would really like to show to you, and that can be a very dangerous command indeed. It can mess you up in ways you can't even begin to imagine yet. That is the command rm. So rm is basically remove. And once you remove things with this command, it's next to impossible to recover pretty much anything. So if I type in rm test.sh, it's going to remove it, and it's no longer going to be there. But if I go ahead and navigate over to place to be, and I don't know, touch test, going to make a new file there. And if I go ahead and say rm place to be, it's going to say rm cannot remove place to be because it is a directory. This is a failsafe of the rm. So you wouldn't delete a full directory because you wouldn't be able to recover it, and that would be really bad. What you can do is type in rm.f and then place to be cannot remove directory. Oops. Okay, no problems. You see, you get stuck. And I'm deliberately going to leave this part in the tutorial just to troubleshoot it. So you type in dash dash help, and here you have recursive remove directories and their contents recursively. So that's a very nice option. So let's just go ahead and do that, because this will go into the folder and remove everything within the folder and the folder itself, hopefully. So let's just go ahead and type in rm-r place to be, press enter. There you go. It has deleted it. And there we go. It is no longer there. The dash f function, dash F that I have used, is forced. It will not ask you any questions. It will delete the folder or file, which can be also very dangerous. When you're using RM, you always want to be asked questions. In any case, I've deliberately left this in order to show you that even if you get stuck, don't worry about it. I get stuck all the time, and if you don't know what to type in, what argument to pass, just type in dash dash help and take a look at what you can actually type, read a little bit, and then use the options. Try it out. Sometimes it's going to work, sometimes it won't, but more often than not, you will be able to figure it out from the help menu. If you can't figure it out from the help menu, just type in man rm, and you can read pretty much everything that there is to know about this command here. And if you really can't perform the task, but if you can't find anything useful here, then forums are your next best bet. but trust me, you will succeed in doing it. In any case, this was a brief introduction to some of the basic commands that we will use. Please make sure that you know what each one of these commands does, at least its basic functions. And then later on, we will get in depth and do more advanced stuff and use more advanced commands by combining them and so on. In any case, I bid you all farewell, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.